All right, I'm going to go ahead and get started. I'm Eric Daniel. I work at Lucity. I'm one of the GIS developers at Lucity. This session is GIS tips and tricks. It's the first time we're offering this. This is kind of what I had planned. There's a few things I was going to cover up front, just the publishing of feature service, some using our default extent, reverse geocode spatial relates, just a few things that either through support, we just noticed that either people are unaware that we offer this functionality, or just some issues we've seen due to publishing feature services. So I was just going to cover that. But really, I kind of want to be more of an open discussion that you guys can, if you guys have current issues that you're dealing with that you want to see how maybe other clients have been working with it or dealt with the similar situations or lessons learned, any other tips or tricks that you guys do that helps your team out and how they utilize our software. So we'll do that the second half of the hour. So I have a few slides to go over, and the first part's about creating feature services. So just a few things to consider. So when you publish it, you have to have a valid spatial reference. You have to have it defined. You should only include layers in the map that you want to edit. And what I'm talking about here is when you open up ArcMap and you're, you know, prior to publishing it, you know, you add your layers into ArcMap. So obviously you don't want to include layers in the map that you don't want users to be editing. All your layers should be from the same source, so you shouldn't try to publish a feature service that has multiple layers coming from different geodatabases. And then your database connection, when you added it to the map, it obviously needs to have edit permissions. So, you know, if you loaded the data into the ArcMap that with a read-only access, then you still won't be able to edit that content inside the feature service. And if you loaded the data using OSA, then you need to make sure that the ArcGIS server account was granted editing permission to the data. I mean, personally, I try to avoid publishing services with using an OSA data connection. I always try to use a named user connection. And if you're working with version data, you know, whatever version you're connected to in ArcMap is the one that's going to be, you know, obviously updated when you edit the feature service. Layers based on views are not supported. Do not duplicate layers in the map. This is also something I see quite a bit where, you know, just I think primarily you guys add multiple layers in the map or the same layer multiple times, maybe for symbology or rendering purposes. But if you're creating a feature service that's going to be used for editing, you should only have that layer in the map once. You can define a default Z value for layers that are Z aware. For layers that are M aware, you can enable the option to insert nulls. If you guys are using geometric networks, there's an additional limitation that the data must be in the same projection and coordinate system used by the editing client application. The following data types are not supported. So the main one here is grouped layers. So if you're using grouped layers, you just won't be able to publish that out as a feature service. And then as far as the actual publishing process, you should run the Lucity alias import tool. So that's a tool that's part of our ArcMap extension. It's a very simple process. You just click the tool before you publish, and it runs through and makes sure that the alias names are configured with Lucity. We also make sure that you have an object ID field, the shape and facility ID fields are all properly defined. So it just does a little bit of validation. This is more important if you're wanting to use that feature service with Lucity. So whether you're loading it in the Lucity web map or mobile maps or with an ArcPro. Yeah, it you can run that. So the question was, do you need to run it every time you publish? It doesn't. You can run it multiple times. It won't hurt to do that. So yeah, I would just say it's probably, yeah, it'd be a good practice just to do it every time you do it. Especially if you're adding in new layers or you've made changes, especially to like the alias name and stuff like that. And that's just showing a screenshot of what that tool looks like, alias import. You get a little dialog, just warns you what it's about to do, and it prints the results out into the Lucity process log. So as far as the publishing dialog, what I'm showing here is just just so you guys are aware, not saying you need to change this, but so whenever you query a feature service, and whether through a REST call or through some of our tools like in the web map, the maximum number of records returned by the server is set to 1,000. So if you're trying to query something and the result is going to be more than 1,000 features, it's limiting to 1,000. Just know that that's there. You can modify it and increase it, but then you're just might it might be a performance hit because then it's bringing across some more features back from the server. So, but that's Esri's default is 1,000. And to actually publish the feature service, all you need to go is click that feature access under the capabilities, and when you do that, it adds a new tab under here for feature access. If you click on that feature access, you have all these options here. And I was going to go over some of these because there's always questions on which ones we require that you guys have enabled. So the create, obviously it allows users to create features. It's only required by Lucity if you're using the Lucity to GIS scheduled task, or if you're using scheduled tasks for street segments or subsegments. And the reason why the create is required for those is whenever you sync a street segment, we automatically recreate your subsegments for you. And so we need to insert those into your subsegment layer. So you'll need to have create enabled on that. If you're only syncing, so the question is, if you're only syncing attributes, from Lucity to your GIS. So that process doesn't really use scheduled tasks. That is, you're talking if you're inside Lucity and you change like some attribute. Yeah. So yeah, that doesn't, that actually, well, it does use a feature service. I'm sorry, it's not using the scheduled tasks, but that process doesn't require, we don't create any features with that process. Delete, obviously that allows users to delete features. It's only required by Lucity if you're using the Lucity to GIS scheduled task and you enabled the option to delete prior inspections. So we do have the ability to basically, like you can have an inspection feature class and you can have a scheduled task that our system will update that feature class to show you the most recent inspections. And so there's an option with that in order if you want to maintain your old inspection data in that feature class or just show the most recent. So if you choose the option to show the most recent, we need to have the delete capability so we can delete the old inspection. Other than that, there's no other process where we're going to be deleting features from your feature service. Extract, that allows users to extract copies of the data. We don't use that. That's not required by Lucity. Query, that allows users to query and view the data. So we do need that because we're always trying to query the service to try to retrieve a feature or obviously you want to view it. Sync, that allows users to work with the data offline, and it is required by Lucity if access to this service is needed in Lucity Mobile offline. So if you're using the service in our mobile maps and you would take those offline, you need to have the sync capabilities. Update, that allows users to update the features, and that's required by Lucity if the service is to be used to accept Lucity to GIS updates. So that would be in the scenario you were talking about. Somebody inside Lucity is changing pipe diameter. We need to have the update capability enabled on that feature service in order to change the diameter in your GIS. Allow geometry updates, allows users to update the geometry of the feature. This is required if you're using that Lucity to GIS scheduled tasks, or again, if you're using scheduled tasks for street segments or subsegments. And again, that's because we recreate those subsegment features for you. So we need to be able to update the geometry. Allow update to true curves. Allows users to replace true curve geometry. We don't require that. This goes with that, only allow curve updates. Yep.
But if you want to create curve GIS and have it shown in the map and all that,
That's good to know. I personally kind of always check all these boxes. I always check the allow geometry updates. I check allow updates to true curves. I do all these defaults by. Okay. Apply default Z values, allows a default Z value to be applied if one is not specified when adding or editing a feature. It's not required, but we do recommend you check that. Allow geometry updates without M values. Again, it's not required, but I recommend checking it. Enable ownership-based access control on features. That allows for advanced restrictions. So basically, users can only access or modify features that they created. It's not required by Lucity, but you have that capability if you want to enable that. Any questions on the feature service part? Alright, so another thing that, I mean, some of you might not be aware, but we do have a concept of a default extent for Lucity, and this is used in a couple places. So if you're using Lucity legacy maps, this is the initial extent used when the map is displayed. So again, in the Lucity web map, you can either use an Esri portal map. And if you do that, we use whatever the default extent is with that portal map, that Esri web map. Or you have the option to use a Lucity legacy map. And if you do that, then the initial extent is going to use, we're going to use the system default extent for the initial extent. And it's also used with the find address tool in the web map. So when you type in an address, it will, and I don't have a screenshot, I don't. When you type in an address, it will, especially, you know, this is very useful if you're using the Esri World geocoding service, because obviously that has addresses all through the world. But so when you're typing in, like, say, 100 Main Street, there's probably a bunch of 100 Main Streets out there. And so if you wanted to narrow down just to find the addresses within your extent, we'll do that. So to set that up, this is in map setup inside UI admin. And it will show you your current extent if you have one. If you don't have one set, you have the option to manually enter it, but I don't know who would do that. I guess you could copy and paste it. Otherwise, you can, where is the button for it? Oh, yeah, you copy and paste a URL to a, you know, if you have a demo, or if you have a boundary layer, or maybe your parcel, something that has a boundary of your area that you would want to set for your extent. you could paste that URL in here and click calculate, and we'll grab the extent from that service. And then the other thing that we have that you guys might not be aware is we do have this concept of a reverse geocode special relate. So special relates are something you configure using the geodatabase config tool, and you set them up against each of your layers. So this is basically a spatial relationship type that uses the asset's location and current geocoder to find the asset's address. So this is a very useful tool of, say you have your hydrants, you have a hydrant layer, but you don't actually have addresses associated to your hydrants, and you want that. You know, it might help the field crews, or just might help anybody to see an actual address associated to that. So to do that, you could set up this reverse geocode spatial relate, and it will take the, when you do, you'll use it just like our force sync tool inside ArcMap, or it's also ran if you do scheduled tasks, it will pick this up. And what it will do is it takes that XY of that asset, and if it's a point, it uses the XY of the point. If it's a line, we use the line's midpoint. If it's a polygon, we use the centroid of the polygon. But we take that XY, we pass it into the locator to see what address it returns. And so we'll take that address that's returned by the locator, and then we'll update the address fields inside Lucity. What's different about this spatial relate is it doesn't require you to have those fields in your GIS. So you don't have to add, you know, again, back to the hydrant scenario, if you don't have address fields in your hydrant feature class, that's fine. You don't need to add them. This tool will just populate the address inside Lucity. However, if you do have the address fields in your GIS, it will populate that too. So it'll populate both of them. And then the other thing about this that kind of gets confusing, is it needs a distance value, and this is basically a search tolerance. Just internally we were testing, and 150 seemed to be pretty good, but it really kind of depends on what type of asset you're talking about, and, you know, kind of physically where is it located versus how your geocoder was built. So, you know, you could create a geocoding service based upon a street center line. So obviously the middle of the road is going to be where that address point is at, versus if you built a geocoding service maybe using parcels, or like you have an address point that's kind of a center of a parcel. So then, you know, that point is going to be in the middle of the parcel. So does that kind of make sense on the locator? So that's why this distance might vary, or why you might have to mess with the distance to see what results you're getting. So yeah, the question is, what would happen if, are you saying if the locator didn't find an address to that?
Yeah.
You just won't get an address for it. Yeah. So, yeah, we'll take, again, we get that XY from the asset, and then we try to pass that into the locator, and if it doesn't return an address, then nothing gets populated. And if multiple addresses are returned, we use the first one, which is as we return, the geocoding service will return it in the order of the highest ranking ones, so we take the first one and use that. More than likely. All right. Well, that is all I had on that special relate. And that's really all I had, the topics I wanted to discuss. So, well, I would say that obviously if you have, it's probably not the best performance to have a feature service that contains hundreds of layers in it. We do internally. I do have a feature service that does contain all the possible layers that are mapped to Lucity, so that's like 200. But and it's just a master copy that I don't actually use in a map or anything. It's just the fallback that Lucity uses to push updates from Lucity to GIS. So it's the one that I define at the geodatabase level inside the geodatabase config tool. But I would never load that into a map. I would never use it for visual display. It's strictly just for us to call with a REST endpoint to make updates to. So that's one thing I would recommend. And then if it is one that you would want to load into a map, then you would probably want to create those separately and smaller down. I don't know if I'm right or wrong. I think Esri recommends just one layer per feature service, but I could be wrong on that. I see it more common that you kind of group similar ones together, like you put a lot of your sewer layers in one feature service, your water ones in one feature service, so forth. But okay. Okay, and those each contain like not many layers. Yeah. And then as far as the performance for scheduled tasks, that kind of depends on how often you're having it run. You know, you can have our scheduled tasks run every minute, but if you're really not making updates to that service, it's basically just that scheduled task is going to run every minute, but it's going to look at your service, say, hey, do any records need to be processed? And if nothing needs to be processed, nothing gets done. And so it's not really, it's just making one query to that service every minute, basically. No. And with the scheduled tasks, you know, it also kind of depends. If you're not using spatial relates, you're not doing number generators or stuff, then really we're just querying the feature service, and we're not really pushing edits to that feature service, so we're not doing updates to it. But, all right. Yeah, so the question's on the Esri water utility network. So we, I kind of have I guess I could show that. We're currently looking at it. We're currently developing against it. So we don't support it right at this moment. And if you guys aren't familiar, the utility network is basically their new geometric network. So if you guys are using ArcMap, you can have a geometric network set up. But their new approach to this is their utility network. And with the utility network, you can't edit a utility network inside ArcMap. You have to go to ArcPro to do your editing now, which is kind of your catch-22, because you can't edit your geometric network inside ArcPro. So that's kind of the distinction between those two. But the thing with the utility network is its schema is something that we don't support. And that's mostly because they grouped all their features into one feature class. And so like your hydrants, your valves, your nodes, your pump stations, they're all in one point feature class. And so as you guys probably are aware, we don't support one feature class can only be mapped to one Lucity module. So we're redesigning our architecture to support that configuration. And in doing so, we are also moving, basically creating our new architecture on how you configure your GIS, removing that into the web. So it'll be part of the admin tools inside the web product. And so we're taking it out from our catalog and we're taking it out of the Lucity admin tool. So We're currently working on that. We hope to have the initial release of that in first part of next year. There's a slight chance I'll make it into this 19R3 release that we were talking about, but I have this enabled right now. I can kind of show. And what you would end up having to do is there's basically a new property we'll have when you configure a layer and you can say what the criteria is. So it uses asset types or subtypes. So there's this asset group field and there's an asset type field. And so it's the combination of those that would determine which Lucity module that asset belongs to. So might have I'll just show you some of my slides for the what's ahead. So it's their next generation of the geometric network. It currently supports electric, gas, water, sewer, and stormwater. It does use an extension now for ArcGIS Enterprise. It's the ArcGIS Utility Network Management. You use ArcPro to do your edits to the utility network. This is kind of the structure that I was talking about. So they have tools that you can load your data into their schema for this new utility network. And it's pretty much these five feature classes. So you have a device, assembly, junction, line, and subnet line. And it does use kind of subtypes. So there's these fields that's called an asset group and the asset type. And that kind of defines, hey, I'm looking at, this is a hydrant, this is a valve. This is an example of, you know, that water device. These are all the different assets that are part of that layer. And as I'm just telling you, that's the main thing why we can't just support it right out of the box, because we have to support this type of architecture. And this is kind of just where we're going. So we'll have in the admin portal now, there's going to be off into this right a new GIS config section. And this is all the where you could set stuff up. So it's going to have more of a feel like our typical modules do, where you can go in here and this is where you would add a layer record and you can specify all the properties about that layer and how we'll go about that. What's that? Well, yeah, we're working on, that's what I've been working on. So it's oh, I should not show these yet because I don't know. Don't ignore those versions thing because I needed to look at that later. But it's going to be kind of a phased approach. So the initial phase will be an early adopter, and it's going to be for those of you that are ready to start using the utility network and want to get it, start messing around with it. So like when it's first available, I don't expect everybody to start implementing this. So the first one is really just trying to get those few users that we have that are trying to implement it. And when they'll be able to go into that admin, that screenshot I showed before, to set up their GIS configuration. It's going to require manual entry. So you're going to have to manually, you can do copy and paste, but you're going to have to manually enter the URL to the service, your field names and all that. You'll have to manually enter that. And we plan to support the Lucity to GIS updates and GIS scheduled tasks. So it will support two-way synchronization with it. What won't be supported up front, and it's going to require you to kind of work around there, all the same asset in the same layer, is you're actually going to need to create, if you saw that meter device layer that had all those different assets, we're we're going to need you to actually publish your services separate. So you like use a definition query to only show hydrants and then publish that as a service. So that way our tools inside, like the web map and Arc Pro, we know that, hey, you're looking at a water hydrant versus a valve. And then the phase two we're talking about is I'll help you guys with the configuration by providing you pop-ups and, you know, when you're doing your field mapping, instead of having to type in the field, I'll give you a list of the fields. Or if you're mapping layers, I can give you a list of all the services you have and stuff like that. And then, portal. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, because it requires that extension that's in ArcGIS Enterprise, which they assume with ArcGIS Enterprise, you guys are all doing the base deployment, which is those, you know, you have server, you have portal, you have your two web adapters, and you have the data store. So, and finally, the last phase would be that the tools will start supporting, if you do have a service, you can have that service that points to your meter device that has all your assets. It doesn't have to be broken out anymore. And our tools inside the web map will know whenever you identify a feature, it's going to look at those other fields to determine, hey, this is a hydrant versus a valve, so forth. And then eventually, the retirement of the Lucity legacy GIS tools. So in theory, you don't even need to use a utility network anymore. We're wanting to move away from the GeoDatabase config tool inside our catalog and the GIS config tool inside UIAdmin. So even if you're not using the utility network works, we're wanting you guys to start using this new setup inside the web to do your GIS configuration. So, but well, yeah, that's what, yeah, that would be the long-term goal. Yeah, we'll have all the same functionality. Well, the functionality that makes sense, some of that, because also part of this is we're kind of going to decouple from the geodatabase. Because, I mean, we're focused more on the feature service side now, accessing things through services, and we really don't need access to your geodatabase for anything anymore. Obviously, ArcMap, doing editing that way, we still do, but we're not wanting, especially cloud clients, you know, obviously we're not hitting your geodatabase, we're hitting stuff through your services. So some of those tools that's inside the geodatabase config tool that actually interact with your geodatabase, those probably aren't going to come across. But it shouldn't be a loss of functionality because there's no need for that anymore. Export shapefiles through Arc. You'll still be able to do ArcMap. Yeah, I mean, that's not a Lucity functionality, so you should. And I'm not, Greg's not in here, is he? I'm not the big pro person, but I think in Pro you could probably export shapefiles. I would think that they still have that. Yeah. But yeah, the utility network, I mean, it's something that you'll definitely need to plan a good amount of time to do that migration. There's a lot of steps involved. Esri does a good job of documenting a procedure and how to get started and all the steps you need to take. But you're going to spend a few days just going through those steps. And then there's the whole process of cleaning up your data. If you're starting from no network, I assume if you're in a geometric network already, the transition might be a little bit easier as far as your data cleanup because it's already, your features should already be like snapped and all that. But for us internally, we weren't using a geometric network, or we had in the past, but we hadn't maintained it. And so I was trying to set our demo data up with it. We were getting a bunch of validation errors. We had to go through and clean it up. But it's, so it's good. It does tell you you got some data issues. So. So yeah, I, the new GIS config tools and the geodatabase config tools are going to be available there for a while. You're going to have the option to use both, but, eventually the ArcCatalog ones are going to go away. Now I do have scripts set up that will transfer, because this is all also all new GIS. I mean, behind the scenes, these are all your GIS configuration is going to be stored in new tables now inside Lucity. So I do have some scripts that will convert your existing GIS configuration into the new one. So, I mean, I plan to have a tool or something available to help you guys do that. But there's also needs, you're going to, if you're still wanting to use our ArcMap tools or ArcGIS desktop tools, which would be ArcMap and ArcCatalog, you're still going to have to use that old configuration. We're not going to make changes to our ArcMap tools to start looking at these new this new configuration. So the new configuration is going to work with ArcPro, our web maps, our mobile maps, the synchronization, the scheduled tasks and all that. But for the new config, we're focusing, the main reason for this is for the support of the utility network. So that's the reason why this first phase, we're trying to just get those users that are trying to use the utility network up and running on it and to get feedback from them prior to exposing this to everybody. So the question is, what version of ArcGIS Server Enterprise would we require? You're trying to think right now. I don't think that there would be a requirement on what version you'd be on. I mean, not anything that we don't require now, which is 10.2.2 or higher. I don't think there will be a requirement. Yeah. And again, these new config, let me just make sure before I say this. You'll notice that there's not even one in here for your geodatabase. Like we are completely, the geodatabase is sort of like how the shapefile was for a while, you know, as you guys had shapefiles and then they came out with the geodatabase model like in the early 2000s and then, or 90, I don't know when it actually was, but like we don't care about that. We don't need access to that anymore with any of our tools besides the ArcMap tools. But like I said, you're not, this configuration isn't going to work for ArcMap. So, we don't need any of, yeah. So I don't think we need to know what version of server you're on. And this is also going to be helpful for you guys that are cloud-based, or even you don't even have, maybe your services are all hosted, like you don't even have a geodatabase. You're using completely hosted feature services for all your GIS content. So again, this would support that. Because our old geodatabase config tool, if you know, that first node is your geodatabase. You have to create a connection to a geodatabase in order to start linking layers. So we're kind of removing that whole concept. And really, you're just setting up layers and you can say, hey, this is the service for that layer. You know, this layer is going to be mapped to this Lucity module. Yep. Yeah. Yeah, this doesn't mean that you guys aren't having a geodatabase anymore. I mean, we still use a geodatabase. You guys, for probably majority of you do. It just means we don't care. We don't need to know that information about it anymore. We just need to know the service information. So yeah, this concept is requiring you guys to have services published, feature services or map services, and for us to access it that way. All right. So any, okay, so for spatial relates and auto numbering, so you're editing, you're just using ArcPro tools to edit your features. Okay, so in Pro, we don't, unlike ArcMap, so our extension ArcMap was sitting there and actually watching your edit session, and all your edits you were doing, we were tracking. And when you saved your edits, we processed all that. ArcPro doesn't do any of that. ArcPro, we're not watching your edit session. We don't know anything about it, what's going on. It all relies on scheduled tasks. So you have to have a scheduled task configured, and then we'll query that service however often. So if you're adding features in ArcPro, and if you have the service running every minute, in a minute, we'll catch those edits and we'll push them into Lucity. And that scheduled task can be configured to use your number generator and your spatial relates. So if you guys are doing that way, just know that, especially that might be kind of confusing for users, but you know, especially for the auto number, they could create a feature, drop a point in ArcPro, and they'll have to wait like a minute. And then the auto number, then it'll populate the auto number, or if there's, so they'll have attributes of. Yeah. Yes. No, okay. So in Pro, we do have some edit tools in Pro, and that's we have a tool that lets you do splits, merges, renumbers, and deletes, because those aren't supported with scheduled tasks. It sounds kind of weird, but even with those, we're not actually doing the edit. And well, so we are doing the split. So inside ArcPro, if you're using our split tool, take that for example. So if you're splitting a sewer pipe in ArcPro and you use our tool, we'll give you the fancy little options on how you want to split your historical data and what attributes you want to have go to which pipe and all that. But we're still relying on the whole Lucity to GIS process that pushes edits to your feature service. So we're making some changes as far as the geometry changes in ArcPro for you, then once you click OK on that split dialog, we're changing those attributes inside, or those the geometry inside ArcPro, but then we're making a REST call to the Lucity, which does the split inside the Lucity side. And on the Lucity side, our business objects, when we save those new pipes, that actually pushes the change back to your GIS. So then it goes back to Pro, and well, it goes back to the feature service that you're technically editing in Pro, and makes the attribute changes and all that. So